Hi, this is Jose Luis here at Parametric Camp, and welcome to another video in our series Advanced Development in Grasshopper. In this video, I would like to start from the beginning and then ask ourselves the question, what is a Grasshopper plugin in the first place? So what kind of code is that? How do we turn code into a plugin? Like that, how do we connect all these dots together? Well, it's going to take us a few videos to unpack this, but for the time being, I would like you to think of a Grasshopper plugin as a collection of C# code to start with that has a particular format and that has a particular way that you need to write this code in so that we can compile it into what becomes a file that then we can drop into our Rhino and Grasshopper environment, and then it somehow, because of that those conventions, those templates, those standards, it becomes a component and becomes a plugin that we can use in Grasshopper. Okay, how that process works, we're going to see it across these videos, but the basic idea is that if you want to first use a plugin, there are, as of the recording of this video, which is, what are we? This is February 2022. As of the recording of this video, there is two main ways to do that. One of them is you can open Rhino and you can just type package manager, and then this window will pop up, which allows you to both install new packages for Rhino and for Grasshopper, both things. So for example, if I type here paneling tools, you can see that paneling tools here is a plugin for Rhino and Grasshopper to build blah, 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 right? So I can click on installs, and then Rhino has now connected to the database and it has downloaded whatever files it needs to make this work. And if I now open Rhino again and I open Grasshopper on the side and go to here, P, you can see that all of a sudden I have this new plugin that gives me all these new components that were not available on my Grasshopper before, and then now give me all this new functionality. But what has happened in the background? What has been downloaded, etc., etc.? Well, if I go to this route, so this will look something like, typically in your Windows machine, it will look something like users, and then the name of your user, in my case, JLX, and then application data, Rumi, MacNeil, Rhino, Zeros, and packages. If you go to this, then you can see that inside of the, in my case, 7.0, the Rhino version that I was working with, I now have paneling tools installed as part of the packages that are available for my Rhino, right? Before, I used to have Parachute. That's the one that I use for displaying this tiny helper text here for the icons. And if I go inside of paneling tools, you can see that there's a bunch of files here that somehow conform my Grasshopper plugin. All right, we will take a closer look at this file, which is the main file for Grasshopper plugins, the GHA file. The other ones are other things that come with paneling tools, because paneling tools also has a Rhino package in itself, and it has these DLL files, which is code that supports the functionality of both. So it's a little, this one example is a little more complicated, right? Before Package Manager, the way we used to download and install packages used to be through the main repository of contributions in the Rhino community, which as of this recording is still called Food for Rhino. If you're watching this in the far distant future, maybe Food for Rhino is now obsolete and you're only using the Package Manager. But as of right now, we're kind of still transitioning between the two. So it's still very popular to go to Food for Rhino and look for some plugin that you like, for example, Machina, which is this plugin that I developed myself, or one of the most popular ones, for example, Pufferfish, right? So let's say we want to download and install Pufferfish. How does that work? Well, I go to Pufferfish in Food for Rhino. If it loads, which is not loading, give me a second. Well, you're not going to believe that, but as I was recording the video, the page literally went down for 5 minutes. So now it's back. So let me do this real quick before we lose it again. So you click on the component, the plugin that you want to download, right? And provided that you are registered and logged into the page, etc., you can go down here to all the different versions and you can download a zip file that I'm going to save somewhere on my desktop. Okay, so I'm going to put that on my desktop, and then you can see that this is going to show up here. And if I extract it here to Pufferfish, blah, 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 you can see that if I click inside, there is basically this main GHA file, the Grasshopper I don't know what A stands for. Mike Pryor has put here some instructions on how to install this. Basically, the way you install this, again, if you're looking this at, if you're watching this from the future, maybe this sounds like super like a troglodyte prehistoric, but you go to Grasshopper, you go to files, you go to special folders, and you go to components folder. And here, in my case, I already have a bunch of previous plugins installed. So what you do is you basically take all these files, and then I'm going to actually copy the thing with the folder itself. So I'm going to go the whole Pufferfish 3.0, and I'm just going to drop it here. And something that you need to do is you also need to right click on the GH file and make sure that you have no blocked check mark anywhere here. Because when you download files from the internet with Windows, then Windows flags them as unsafe and it blocks them from executing. So sometimes you need to manually undo that. Then you restart, you can restart your Rhino and your Grasshopper, you have to restart it. And then once you do that, then you can see that now Pufferfish is showing up here on my Grasshopper, all right? So what that means is that somehow there is a way to create these GHA files. And once you create that file, then making it available in your Rhino environment, either via the package manager, as we did with paneling tools, or by manually downloading it and putting it in a special folder called libraries, either those two ways, for some reason, makes Grasshopper realize that there's this new repository of code that shall be loaded and displayed here on your screen. But how do we even create that GHA file in the first place? Well, surprise, surprise, we're going to do that by writing our own C# code. And it turns out that, as we will see in the next video, Grasshopper plugins are basically a collection of code that is inheriting from a set of classes and a set of special code that is available inside of the Grasshopper Software Development Kit, the SDK. We've seen some of that in previous videos. And then the way we build Grasshopper plugins is by taking those template classes, if you will, subclassing them or extending them with our own versions, and then overriding some of the properties that make those components work. So for example, this is the code of the Machina plugin that I develop in my free time when I can spend some time doing this. And this is specifically the Grasshopper plugin that uses Machina and that allows it to work in Grasshopper. So you can see that the source code, there is a main assembly that has the information about the plugin itself. But then in order to, for example, have the robot create or the robot version or the logger, those components, the robot create is a component that has basically subclasses from this generic Grasshopper component that has a bunch of overrides. So we have to write specific parts of code in specific places. We're going to see all of this, right? And then as soon as and this is, for example, the compiler program, that the code is a bit more involved, etc., but it's quite simple still anyway. And as soon as we have all of this and all the components that we liked as part of our project, what we can do is we can compile this, turn it into that Grasshopper H file, and then load it into our Grasshopper environment. Okay? Now, how does that look? We're going to see it on the next few videos, but surprise, surprise, In order to follow the next videos, what I'm going to ask from you is that you get some familiarity with writing C# code inside of Visual Studio, which is this environment that I'm showing here, and which is the one that we're going to be using for development. So if you know how to write C# code and you've used Visual Studio a couple times, then you are probably on a good position to start learning from what I'm going to be showing in the next videos. Otherwise, if you don't know how to write C#, then you're probably not in this video anyway, because we've done it so much in the previous examples. But if you want to get a bit more familiarity with Visual Studio, then I recommend you go to my other playlist, Learning C#, and there's a bunch of videos on Visual Studio, how Visual Studio works, etc., etc. So I recommend that you check them out. They're going to show up somewhere over here as a card, and there will be links in the description of this video. Okay? Beautiful. So without further ado, let's move on to the next video, where we're going to write our first simple plugin. Oh, and I'm going to teach you how to install the templates and the basic code to run Grasshopper plugins in Grasshopper. Okay? If you like this video, maybe hit the thumbs up button, maybe join the channel, maybe subscribe to the channel, whatever you want. All right? See you in the next video. Bye-bye.